3 years ago, stood in front of, well, not this sign, this is a new sign, a sign right around here, and introduced a new podcast. I called it a podcast program that I didn't really quite have the name for. You now know it as Ham Radio Now, and this is approximately episode 189. Not 188 was the last one I recorded. I'm pretty sure this will show up as 189, but I can't guarantee that, but I can guarantee that it's Ham Radio Now. 3 years ago, and here at the Orlando HamCation, where I was limping around with a hernia. Okay, so the hernia got fixed. Cliff Broughton, W4FT, was my cameraman back then, and he's not with me today. He is out in California this weekend. So I'm here on my own. But I did have some help in getting down here. I'll tell you about that in another program. I recorded an awesome one-take introduction to episode one. Hey, everybody, welcome to... Well, wait a minute. I'm not quite sure what I'm welcoming you to. I got to check my GoDaddy account and see if I've won my auction. And then, for some reason, I felt like I had to explain what the program is all about. This is actually the pre-introduction to the podcast. I shouldn't have done that. Should have just used that one great take. Well, we are back here in Orlando. I'm not going to do the full Orlando tour. Not that much has changed. It's just still a good ham fest. Lots of basic ham radio stuff, flea market, exhibitors, forums, things like that. So if you want to see what the Orlando HamCation is all about, then head back to episodes one and two and you'll see what's there. I'll show some B-roll pictures as I'm talking here for a minute. But I did have a couple of specific goals in coming down here. Over there is that big RV area where there's tons of RVs, and I know some folks that have been in the RV scene and in ham radio and RVs, and I thought, well, there's probably a pretty good story there. So I sat on and did one, and that's going to come up in another episode or two. And then we all know that CQ Magazine has been having some trouble. So Rich Moseson, W2VU, the CQ editor, was down here, and I talked to him, and that's coming up. It was just going to be buried in this episode as a five-minute conversation, and of course we couldn't stop talking, so that's going to be a separate episode as well. So that's all coming up. And then there's some other stuff that I looked at around the HamFest that, frankly, I can't even remember what it was right now. It's always a great surprise to me to go play back the material and see what I got.
We've got a new box, a hardware, FreeDV in a box.
The first person that I encountered, though, when I got here was the chairman, Peter Meyer.
Okay.
Hold that microphone right up in front of you, okay. Like the professional you are. You are a professional broadcaster, right?
Yes, I am.
Am I on camera? Oh, yeah, I'm on camera.
Okay.
You're a professional broadcaster.
Retired. Yeah, absolutely.
He's still in charge of this thing?
Yes, of the 69th Orlando HamCation, and the weather conditions are beautiful.
No, the weather conditions are cold. It's going to go below freezing tonight. Every time I come down here, it's cold. We're in Florida. It's freaking cold, although it's kind of nice out here right now.
But there's no rain, so we are dry.
Okay. How's the HamFest going to be?
Well, we after a year of preparations with a great team of chairmen, we have 16, and the 145 volunteers, we have a great HamCation so far. The first visitors come in, and we have a lot of vendors. Commercial is completely sold out.
Sold out.
Sold out.
Okay.
We have... Just a few tables left in the swaps. We have more tailgaters and we have more RV people. So what can I say?
You know today is Friday the 13th.
That's the reason I tried to go the easy way, yeah.
And you know tomorrow is Valentine's Day.
I know.
You got hit with Valentine's Day in the HamFest like 3 out of 7 years, right?
That's true. But
I didn't even notice that before. But I mean, how do guys get to come here on Valentine's Day?
This is Valentine's Day. What the heck?
That is a good question.
Is this your first choice for Valentine's Day?
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
It certainly is.
After 53 years, it doesn't matter anymore.
You're standing in line at a ham fest. Early in the morning, it's cold, and it's Valentine's Day. What's up with that?
I need someone to cuddle.
Who are you attached to here?
I got my dad here.
Oh, your dad. You drug your daughter to a ham fest.
Absolutely.
On Valentine's Day.
Look at that.
So she's unattached? She's single?
Sure, she is.
Okay. And looking for... Oh, no, you're not.
Surprise!
Doesn't know you. Okay. Because I was going to say, you're not going to find a guy here.
Well, they have the possibility to buy the nice gift for your wives or for your girlfriends. We have jewelry people over here, so there must be reason to buy some.
Oh, you know, the Hera Arena, where they have the Dayton Ham Fest, is fallen down. I don't know if they've got another place to go. Are you guys ready to pick up the slack? You want to become Dayton if they can't make it anymore?
Well, I
hope... Watch out, Dayton. Watch out.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I hope for the best for Dayton because we are not in... We are in competition, but not a stiff competition. And like we have our operation, they have theirs. And I wish them all the best for their exhibition, for their hamvention.
You can tell them right to the camera.
Well, actually, okay, guys. Oh,
to this
yeah.
camera. Pick a camera, any
okay,
camera.
Okay, well there. Okay, guys, I heard about some problems with your venue, but I can tell you I wish you, on behalf of the Orlando HamCation, all the best with your show, and I'm sure you like our show because there's now a representative over here from Dayton HamVention.
Okay, see you guys in May.
Today, I'm recording this on the last day as things are just about winding down, but you're seeing it at the beginning of everything, but... Today, I talked to Peter again, and he said that the attendance was up a little bit. They're looking around 13,000. So, yeah, maybe not quite ready to take over for Dayton if Dayton has trouble, but they're getting close. They're geographically not in a great place to take over for Dayton. You know, Dayton's middle-ish of the country. It's a good spot for them. So the flea market, indoor flea market building, and then there's the commercial building 3. The guys with the inflatable towers were back. Saw them the first year. Didn't see them the second year. Wasn't here last year, and then and now they're back. And some new products there. And I didn't visit very many manufacturers, but I did stop to see this interesting new product, especially since it's in the SDR realm. It's from Italy, not the first country that you think of when you think of ham radio. Well, we're looking at this. It's Elad.
Yes, this is Elad. I'm coming from Italy, but we have also a facility in Chicago here in US.
All right, and the product is a cute little software-defined transceiver. Let me get the camera down here. And give me just the basic overview of what this radio is and what it does.
Yes, this is the FDM Duo. This is a completely software-defined radio. It is a standalone transceiver, QRP standalone transceiver, and can be used standalone and with the PC. With the PC, you can have all the features of the transceiver. It is a direct conversion receiver from 10 kilohertz to 54 megahertz, and can transmit in all the bands, available bands in this range, frequency range.
So it does, it's, we've been learning about software-defined radio, especially here on Ham Radio Now. It does its digital conversion pretty much right at the antenna.
Yes, this is a direct direct sampling receivers. Yes, it's completely digital.
Okay, so in that regard, it's like the new Flex series.
Yes, yeah.
Except it's very small.
It's very small and have a smart modulator that can be used standalone.
Right, so you can use it just right off of its own front panel. You don't need to be connected to the computer. But if you do connect to the computer, what else do you get? What gets added?
You can see the spectrum. You can may have four receiver per channel. You may have two channels simultaneously. So you can operate in 40-meter band and in the same time in the 20-meter band.
And it is 5 watts, so it's fairly, you know, what they call QRP these days.
Yes, it's nominally it's 5 watts guarantee in all the bands, but if you put the power output to maximum, you can reach up to 8 to 10 watts.
All right, and it can be amplified, you know, with an amplifier, external amplifier.
Yes, you can amplify it. There is a relay output, so you can drive an amplifier, yes.
All right. You were calling this a pretty high-performance radio. You like the specs?
Yes, I think so. I think so. You can make a lot of things with this radio. It's versatile. You can use it in many, many applications.
Yeah. I don't see room inside for a battery. At 5 watts, what is this pretty good for operating in the field off of a battery?
The power consumption in RX mode is about 500 milliamperes, so it's not so high, but not also so few. So, but it's a SDR radio, is not a conventional receiver.
Yeah, so you got a processor to keep going in there.
Yes, there is a lot of a very fast logical inside, so drive more current.
Okay. You have a receiver-only version of this radio, right?
Yes, we have the receiver-only version, and also with the working with the PC and the same software. This is called FDM-S2. Very is beginning to come very popular also here in US. And in the next months, we will have also Duo R, that is a receiver-only version of the Duo. And so also this we can work standalone.
Okay, so right now the receiver is just the box that needs the computer, but the standalone receiver is coming.
Yes, it will come.
Okay.
Will come in next week's in Europe, and after FCC approval, we will have also here in US.
So very quick.
Yeah. It's almost finished now.
So everybody's going to want to know how much this transceiver is going to cost. What's the price range?
For the receiver, we start from 580 to the transceiver's version is $1,280.
And where is that available?
It's available in our website located here in U.S. In Chicago.
So your shipping is from the U.S.?
Yes, sure.
All right. Is there anything else? There's so much about a radio like this that you could talk about. You could go into a lot of technical detail. We're not going to do that. But is there anything about the way this radio works that you would love to tell people that they'd be surprised to hear or that you think is really important?
I suggest to download the software and try it. You can download from our website and see what it can do.
Okay, so the software is free?
Yes, absolutely. And the software is constantly upgraded and released free on our website.
Is any of this open source or is it all pretty much your own stuff?
No, there is no open source, but we release some DLL compatible with WinRAD and XTIO DLL. So who want to make porting for our hardware can make, we release the SDK for that.
This is a very interesting product. I hadn't seen it before. You said that you had shown it at Dayton, but it just came on the market in last December 2014. So it's available now, but it's very new.
Yes, it's new. It's new for this market. We started to sell the transceiver in August in Europe, and then at December in US.
And I was asking about how a ham radio came out of Italy, not where we usually expect ham radios to come out of, and you do technology for a big company, and decided to add ham radio to the technology you've already been developing.
We have a small company in Italy. We have other business special for test instruments, for electromagnetic compatibility. So we also have such kind of communication receivers.
So you said, I can make a ham radio with this stuff.
Yes. We share the same technology. We work for 4 years to develop this technology, and we share from test instruments and communication transceivers.
Well, thank you very much, Franco. I appreciate you talking to me. And ciao is hello. What's goodbye?
Goodbye to all, and ciao again.
Ciao, like Hawaii. Aloha. Ciao.
Ciao.
Thanks. Hey, Mel Whitten.
Hey, Jerry, good to see you.
You got something cool for FreeDV, I understand.
Yes, we do. Yes, we've got a new box, a hardware, FreeDV in a box.
And this is the FreeDV speaker mic thing that David Rowe has been talking about, the guy that invented codec too.
Yes, SM1000.
You can't talk until I put this in front of your face.
SM1000, yeah.
Okay, and you've got a prototype of it.
I do. Yes, I do.
I'll point my point of view camera down there. Tell me about it.
Yeah. This is the SM1000, as you can see.
It doesn't look much like a microphone to me.
Yeah, but it can be held as a microphone, a microphone speaker up here.
Also, no, this is a very prototype, right? Yeah, the finished one's going to look better.
Yeah, it's getting close, but it will be, I believe, in this enclosure as we're looking at it here today. It will have a
volume. So it will look like this?
Yes, it will look a lot like this, yeah. You'll be able to flash upgrades through the USB, through your PC right here. It's got a bunch of controls across the back, on and off here. And here is a cable to your rig. I think that's probably a Yaesu pinout. And you can also have external speaker, microphone, push-to-talk, mic input rig, and rig speaker right here. These are all available, as well as a connector going directly to the radio here.
Okay, now as usual, I put the cart before the horse. FreeDV is digital voice for HF.
Yes.
And up until now, in order to use it, you had to tie in a computer running a software program.
No more. The computer's built in, the codec too, and the software all in this box.
So it's going to be much, much easier. There's no waterfall on that, is there?
No. Good, but you'll have the advantage of being able to use this mobile as well. Obviously, yeah.
Okay, how's FreeDV doing these days?
It's doing quite well, yeah. Yeah, we have a lot of stations on. The QSO Finder has helped a lot to bring new guys on. You know, with this chat channel has helped a lot.
Still mostly on 14.236?
And actually, it's spread out some more now than what it has been in the past, especially the Europeans. There's a lot on 40 and 75 meters. And we've had recently a lot of activity on 10 meters as well. So it's
okay.
Very good.
So FreeDV is, but I guess the word free means it doesn't cost you anything.
Right.
It's open source.
Open source for Linux, Apple, and of course Windows. Yeah.
Of course.
From XP to 10. Yeah.
It's a very narrow mode.
Very narrow mode, yeah. 1.3 kilohertz or less. Yeah. So it's very narrow. It does half of what does in sideband, so.
And, it is becoming more and more robust. I know that David Rowe, the guy, the VK, what's this called?
VK5DGR, yeah.
Yeah, he's the guy that invented Codec 2,
right.
And that's the codec that it relies on. Not using MELP anymore, huh?
No, not MELP anymore. That's a bad word.
You said MELP!
Yeah, that's a bad word. First three letters are okay, but after that, it's a problem. Yeah.
Yeah, Bruce Perrin said you didn't go to jail for that.
No.
MELP was the codec that the original DV stuff used. It was not technically available.
It had less than 5% of real proprietary code in it, but anyway.
Yeah, it was a good codec, but it wasn't something that could be licensed.
It was something we found and we hacked on and we used it for a while. Yeah.
So Bruce Perrin strong-armed David Rowe into inventing Codec 2.
Yes, yeah.
And now that's going place.
That's going, yeah, going very well.
It's got commercial applications, too.
Yes, it has. Yeah, David also added some forward error correction into it, and that helped to give it a little more robustness. So it's working down to 2 or 3 dB SNR now.
And that's what I was asking before I took myself out on a fantasy trip here. The idea is it is almost as good as sideband in terms of signal to noise right now?
Almost. And it is getting better, and he's also working on an even more robust version of it, too. And we should see that sometime next year.
And it's getting to the point where it doesn't have that digital cliff anymore. Whenever people talk about digital voice,
right.
It's like there or not anymore.
Yeah, it kind of gracefully degrades. It just doesn't fall off all of a sudden, yeah. You can start, it'll start dropping words, but you're still picking up words. It just doesn't go away until the noise gets, you know, extremely high, and then it'll fall completely off.
And as I've heard David describe it and others, it relies on the world's most sophisticated computer for error correction, the human brain.
Your human brain, yeah. So
All right, so this is exciting, but it's I mean, I guess I was thinking more ICOM speaker mic. This is more ham radio speaker mic.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it's a nice box. It's well built, you know. I think it's going to be a seller.
And it's going to be a commercial product. It's not a kit, not something that you home brew based on a parts list.
No, it's a complete, ready to go when you plug it in.
Where's it going to be available?
I don't know. I think within a couple of months. Yeah, not long.
Are they going to try dealers and stuff?
I don't know that. We'll have to find out from David Rowe's website.
Okay, so it's coming through David. David is the guy selling it. Uh-huh. Look who's standing behind you. Don't be very quiet. Yeah. We don't want to attract this guy's attention. Come on all the way into the on-camera range.
All right. Does this still focus? Yeah. Hi, it's Kilo 6 Bravo Papa.
I understand you're doing a forum tomorrow, and you've got some interesting stuff of your own to being photobombed by the FreeDV. You got some interesting stuff in a forum tomorrow.
So I think it's at 8:45 in the morning.
12:30.
What?
12:30.
I think they may have moved it. I'll check.
Oh, signs still say 12:30.
Oh, okay. And so, yes, we're really well informed here about when we're speaking. But anyway, we are about to submit for manufacture the third version of White Box. And your faithful viewers have obviously already heard about White Box, which is our 50 to 1,000 megahertz software-defined transceiver with built-in computer, including gate array. And it can do everything. It's got everything in the kitchen sink in it.
And this is going to become a commercial product as well.
It's going to start as an amateur product because the hams are the early adopters and the innovators.
Well, by commercial product, I mean I buy one, turn it on, it works for me.
Yeah, it's probably going to start as a Kickstarter, and then it will be something that you can just order from us as well. And we had this problem where we made all this great codec and digital voice stuff, and it wouldn't work on a walkie-talkie because no one made an HT that was programmable and had floating point. And you know what? Nobody even made an HT that I can program without reading the manual. So we're going to solve both those problems.
See, your problem is you are not enough of an appliance operator. I am too much of one. You are not enough of one.
You know, sometimes anybody is an appliance operator, because no matter how sophisticated someone is, if they've been spending all their time on technical stuff, they pick up their HT and they see a bunch of TLAs, three-letter acronyms.
And your HT looks like a five-fingered HT.
Right. Mm. And they have no idea how to do it. So I must have 7 or 8 different HTs by now. I'm not sure I could program one of them to do scanning. Now, obviously, I already have a smartphone, and I've never read the manual for my smartphone. No one asked me to read the manual. I'm not sure if there even is a manual. So what's wrong with this picture? Why aren't HTs as smart as smartphones? Why aren't they smarter? We're solving that problem.
All right, I'm looking forward to the forum. It probably won't be part of this show, but it will be a show coming to Ham Radio Now very soon, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Thanks very much.
And Mel, thank you.
Yeah, thank you for talking.
And
to you.
This looks really cool. Any idea what it's going to sell for?
$195.
That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or all of a sudden we're all on DVD. Right. Expect. We need to center ourselves back on the camera. Okay. Well, I got no cameraman. Okay. Do you expect this is going to make FreeDV really boom?
I think it's going to help tremendously. Yes.
Have you guys
like to operate at mobile and haven't been able to really do that easily? And this will make that. And it eliminates the computer. A lot of people don't want to work with software. So this.
Well, I mean, even if you want to or it doesn't bother you, it adds a lot of complexity.
It adds complexity, yes. And this will be a plug-and-play FreeDV.
Have you guys tried very much lining up FreeDV signals side-by-side on the band to see how close you can get?
Yes, you can run them very close together.
How close?
I would say we've ran them side by side within 2.6 kilohertz. So okay. That, you know, that's right next to each other, yeah.
So that's two FreeDV signals in the space of one single sideband signal.
Yeah, the filters are very, very good. I mean, they're just rock wall. I mean, there's brick wall filters, so you can run it right up against each other.
That's the software filter inside of FreeDV, right?
Yeah, the FDM modem. Yeah, the actual modem itself.
What would you do with your, you're still running it in an HF rig, which has got its own RF filters in the IF. What would you set those filters for?
I just leave them in the single sideband position. It really doesn't make much difference because of the filtering of the modem itself is so good that narrowing it down doesn't really make that much difference. Just leave it in the single sideband mode. And that allows you to quickly go to sideband in the analog mode if you need to. If you narrow down all your filters and transmit, and you need to go to analog all of a sudden, you've got to widen them back out again. So we normally just run them full 2.6, 3 kilohertz wide.
You still running into a problem of interference from sideband stations that think you're just power line noise?
Yeah, we still hear a lot of that. But again, that's the advantage of having the analog mode is going and educate them that there is actually a signal here and communications going on.
Okay, so what's the official name for this speaker mic?
SM1000.
The SM1000, and we were all be on FreeDV, and that's it from here. Thanks.
Yes, sir. Thanks again.
So, some episodes coming up. We're going to see our talk with the folks in the RV zone. Also, Bruce Perrins, K6BP, did another talk on his Algorand, the white box, and the VHF-UHF version of software-defined radio. So we'll see that. He's got some updates from the talk that he gave at the Tapper conference, and I need to get him on the Skype line. Now, he won't do Skype, not open source enough. Need to get him on Google Hangout and get some updates that aren't quite so technical. This is be a pretty technical one. So plenty of stuff coming up almost immediately here on Ham Radio Now, and then it's going to be time to go to Dayton. Okay, yes, so that's it for this episode. I think that's it for this episode. At least I hope that's it. I've enjoyed this year's HamCation. It was chilly to begin with. It's beautiful out here now. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, it's February. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. Over. And into the HamFest.
And there is the winner of the grand prize. Oh, man. It is K4, Charlie, Bravo, November. Thank you for being with us. I'll see you next year.